My knowledge of temple architecture is next to nothing. The experts in this field may give a different perspective of development and representation in the temple architecture. No doubt it is important. But it is more relevant what the structure directly communicates to a common man. After all, seeing a beautiful scene, object, a structure is a personal experience. And that is what I am going to share with you. The rule of mighty Chola dynasty from later half of 9th century to the early 13th century was the golden period of Dravidian art and culture. The temples of Brihadadeshwara, Airavateshwara and Gangaikonda Cholapuram are examples of it. It was later nurtured by rulers of Vijayanagar, Nayakas and Marathas.
Om Gananantva Ganapati Kumhavamahe Kavinka Venamu Pamashravastamam Jeshtarajam Brahmanam Brahmanaspata Anasrunvan Nutivisidasadanam.
Today, we find the Gopur as an integral part of the Dravidian temple architecture. It is the most visible part of the temple. Its tall structure can be seen from miles away, announcing the presence of a Kovil, a temple. The Gopuras are the gateways to the walled temple complex. One of the main cardinal direction Gopur is treated as a main Gopur. There are other minor Gopuras inside the temple complex. The Ranganath Swami Temple at Srirangam, Trichy has 23 Gopuras. The concept of a Gopur can be seen in Kailashnath's temple plan, which is from Pallava period. A small Gopur over a gateway. This concept is elaborated in mid-Chola period, but still the Gopur is much smaller than the Viman, the superstructure over the Sanctum Sanctorum, as seen in Brihadareshwara and Airavateshwara temple plan. Strictly speaking, Brihadeshwara temple Gopurs are not conventional Gopuras, but rather victory memorials of Raja Raja, the builder of Brihadeshwara. The first and a larger gate is named Keralantakan Thiruvasala, destroyer of Kerala country, and the second one is directly named Raja Raja Thiruvasala. The tall Gopuras appear in later part of Chola rule, and when Nayakas restored and renovated some of the temples ransacked by Malik Kafur, the general of Alauddin Khilji in 1309 to 1311. Usually, the Gopur is based on a rectangular massive stone structure. In my ignorance, I had the impression that the superstructure of the Gopur and the figurines mounted on it are also of stone, which is not so. It is of brick and mortar, except for the early and mid-Chola temples such as the Airavateshwara temple and Brihadeshwara temple. The early structures of Gopuras were with brick and mortar with few figurines. In the desire to build tall gopuras, some gopuras remain unfinished. The tallest gopura of Ranganath Swami Temple remained unfinished till 1987, for more than 450 years, till Ahobila Mutt finished the job. Some of the gopuras are crowded with figurines. It is hard to find rhyme or rhythm in it. Usually, the lowest rung has depiction of material and carnal pleasure. On the upper rungs, the themes become mythological and more spiritual. It is left to the artist to choose the theme. But interestingly, a pair of fierce-looking dwarapals is always present. Compared to the usual gopura shapes, the slender tall gopura of Venkatramana Temple in Jinju Fort is interesting. There are interesting close to bas relief work type carvings in the doorways. The brick and mortar structure needs periodic maintenance and repair. The long spacious corridors and the various mandapas, that is halls, is a special feature of temple architecture. They were essential to accommodate large number of devotees gathered on special occasions and the processions of residing devata on designated vahan. The basic plan of Dravidian temple architecture went through many additions as the temple grew in size. The Rameshwar temple encloses 15 acres. There is a mini township between the first and the second enclosure wall of Srirangam temple. The Meenakshi temple plan shows how complex the temple layout becomes when many structures are added over a period of time. Massive rectangular pillars support the corridors. They provide ample space for the artist to display their art. In the Pallava period, the pillars had animal motif, usually vyal or yali. The Kailashna temple of Kanchipuram is an example of it. This theme is adopted in Chola period also, but for the few frontline pillars. Airavateshwara temple is an example of it. The other rectangular pillars are used to carve the scenes from the Shiva Puran and other themes. Another popular motif for decorative pillars is that of horse or vyal riders. Usually it is found at the entrance of the mandap, such as Kalyan Mandap. In the Ranganath Swami temple at Srirangam, some foreigners are also recorded on the pillars. For the capital of the pillar, the motif of a lion with open mouth is found in many temples spanning a long period of time. Sometimes two tiers of capitals and a time member are used to increase the width of the passage at the ground level. Thank you. There are decorative pillars forming non-structural members. The fluted and round pillars were introduced in a later period. In the halls of many pillars, such as Mandapam of Thousand Pillars, pillars are mostly plain. In most of the temple halls, ceilings are plain. Airavateshwar temple has beautiful carvings on the Mandapam ceiling. The Kalyan Mandap of Jalakandeshwar has a ceiling design of parakeets drinking from a lotus-shaped fountain. In some temples, the ceiling frescoes have survived. The beautiful fresco of Balakrishna in a lotus pond is a fine example of Tanjore painting. We don't see the original fresco, in which the sculptures were coated with a thin layer of lime and then painted. We see on some sculptures a broken layer of lime and a quality of the original paint. Some of the old temples follow a simple, uncluttered layout and use the temple outer walls and niches to house the parivar deities. The Airavateshwar temple has a plan to show the Sanctum Sanctorum rising from a lotus. To enhance this effect, the structure was surrounded by a shallow water channel. In the evening, big circular oil lamps were lighted to enhance the temple beauty. For Mandapam of Airavateshwar, the plan is that of a chariot. In the niches, there are interesting sculptures. One is that of Harasimha. The legend says, to pacify Narasimha after the Hiranyakashipu vath, Shiva took a form of a more ferocious Narasimha called Harasimha and brought down Narasimha on his laps. there is a unique statue of Hara Pitamaha, Shiva, in the form of a Brahmadev. There is a rare statue of Ashwani Kumar, the Rajavaidya of Devas. Ashwani Kumars were twins. Notice how it is indicated by two identical figures at the base of the statue. Vayu Devata with a fluttering flag in its hand. In the Airavateshwara temple, one finds many vacant niches from where the statues are removed to some museum or a private collection. When there are no serpentine lines of surging frenzied crowds of devotees and shouting and pushing temple attendants, allowing you a fleeting glimpse of the deity smothered in Vastralankar, the darshan becomes a beautiful moment. The Gangaikonda Cholapuram temple is a tribute of a victorious son, Rajendra Chola, to his illustrious father, Raja Raja Chola. After defeating the Pal dynasty of Bengal, Rajendra Chola built this temple on the lines of Brihadadeshwara temple, built by his father, but with some changes to enhance its beauty. Notice the fine curve of the rising Viman against that of Brihadadeshwara Viman with straight rise. The temple has some of the finest sculptures. The Kailashnath temple at Kanchipuram exhibits the beauty of sculptures from the Pallava period. From the diversity of the themes for the sculptures, it appears there was a degree of autonomy given to the artists. There are some fine frescoes in Brihadeshwara. The king is not with four arms. It is an artistic rendering of the action of Namaskar. Apart from not so common sculptures, there are some themes found in many temples. One finds resemblance in themes and sculptures in different temples built at different places in different time period. There would have been artists belonging to a certain tradition or school of sculpture. The temple of Brihadeshwara and Gangaikonda Cholapuram are World Heritage Sites and maintained at high standards. What is surprising is those temples which are under Archaeological Survey of India are also repaired, reconstructed and maintained well. The Vimana of Airavateshwara temple was given a chemical treatment to prevent it from weathering. The Kailashnath temple is clean and sports a clean surrounding with a lawn. The sites are fenced and protected. Thank you. The rich temple trusts carry out periodic maintenance. Some temples are restored, and in some cases, new construction is carried out in a such a way that it merges with the original construction. Apart from being worldly abode of gods, temples are custodians of culture, tradition and art. They offer solace to the faithful, a meeting point or a place for a rest away from the chaos of the world.